Alhamdulillahi wa kafa. Wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa. Amma ba'd, fa'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Walladhina jahadu fina lanahdiyannahum subulana. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun alal mursalin. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. So I think what we'll start with this time are some of the pages in the first few chapters that have issues that we want to point out. Otherwise, it might just be that we push it off every time and never really get to it. So I'll mention where it is relative to the edition I have, which I think is one of the old editions. So the page numbers may not necessarily match up. But in the very first chapter, in the second paragraph, so we mentioned this last time, that the author says, but the bitterness of feeling arose between the mistress and the handmaiden, and hunger fled from the anger of Sara. So this is not correct. If there were some feelings, then that's a different story. But the way that he words it is not really appropriate. These were both two righteous women of Islam, and so they would have acted accordingly. In the next paragraph, he mentions that when the boy reached the age of 13, Abraham was in his 100th year. So there's different narrations about, I don't know if it's wrong necessarily, but like Imam Suyuti says when he was 7, something when he was 9. So there's different narrations about his age that come. On what's my page 2, this one paragraph starts, two spiritual streams, two religions, two worlds for God, two circles, therefore two centers. So it's sort of vague language, so it's not 100% clear what does he mean by these two centers. But again, this sort of perennialist feeling that, does he mean Christianity in Islam or Judaism in Islam or what? Now generally, if you were to speak about sort of the two centers in Mecca early on, it would have been Mecca itself, the Kaaba and Taif, were sort of the two centers. But he's not really referencing it because this is talking about way before that. So whatever he's referencing, the point is there's one center, and that's Islam. And when Islam came, and when the prophethood began for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then that was the only acceptable religion before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there can be no Christians, valid Christians today. There can be no Judaism today that's accepted before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Isa came, the Jews became Christian. And when the Prophet came, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, anybody who was on that line of truth, there were no true Christians in the sense of the teachings of Isa, but whatever was left of that Hanif, leaning towards truth, they had to become a Muslim. And that's all there is. So there's one center, basically. So this he kind of mentions here and there. And later in that same paragraph he mentions, the books do not tell us how Hajar and her son reached Bakka. Perhaps some travelers took care of them. But we know that Ibrahim alayhi wasallam took them, because he was walking away and she was saying, where are you going? So it doesn't make sense that they sort of on their own made their way there when there's nothing there and Ibrahim met them there, right? Which is what he would sort of is what's being insinuated here. So I'm not sure why he would say that, because it's clear in sort of all the narrations and traditions that Ibrahim was there and then walked away and all these things happened. So obviously they went together as a family and ended up there. He mentions different verses from the book of Genesis in different places from older books. And so below that paragraph he mentions in the words of Genesis, and God heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of God called to Hajar out of heaven and said to her, what aileth thee, Hajar? Fear not, for God had heard the voice of the lad where he is, meaning Ismail. Arise and lift up the lad and hold him in thy hand, for I will make him a great nation. And God opened her eyes and she saw a well of water. So this is not necessarily a mistake, he's quoting the book of Genesis. But this last bit, that I will make him a great nation, and God opened her eyes and saw a well of water. So this is actually what's giving preference to Islam, right? And this is what we're saying, is that Islam is a continuation of Haqq, which started with Adam and at different times took on names, Christianity, Judaism, Islam. But this idea of Islam is submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to His oneness and to truth. So even in the book of Genesis, it's saying that from him is going to come a great nation. And one thing is clear, that we're the only ones who hold that line of Ismail. Everybody else takes from Ishaq. And even so, the Jews in Yathrib were waiting for a prophet. And because he didn't come in the line that they expected, then they rejected. He didn't come to the line of Ishaq, which is what all of Bani Israel had come through. So even in the book of Genesis, it's interesting that, you know, what he's quoting here, that I'll make him a great nation. What does that mean, right? It has to give some preference towards the line of Ismail, continuing on this idea of prophethood. And then on page three, this paragraph that starts when Hajar and Ismail reach their destination. And I'm sort of mentioning this because anybody who has a copy, it's worth just making notes or just underlining that portion or putting a little star. And even if you were to give that book to somebody, then afterwards, you know, you did a sadaqah for them, that they will have some sense that there's some, even if you don't write out the full thing, just underline it, a little star or something, to know that these are some of the areas that you need to look out for. So it goes on, its name, the Kaaba, or comma, cube, is in virtue of its shape, which is approximately cubic. So the Kaaba, and we mentioned this, I think, in the session in one of the other ones, that the Kaaba was not a cube. It is today a cube, but it was not originally built as a cube. And we'll touch on this a little bit when we talk about the building of the Kaaba. So this idea, the word itself can take the meaning of cube, but it doesn't make sense then in a literal meaning. So he's sort of mentioning that as a cube is incorrect, because the Kaaba, when it was originally built, was a rectangular shape. And I don't think there's anything in the second chapter. There was one or two other things somewhere. So in the fourth chapter, the recovery of a loss at the very beginning, he says the two ends of the wall stop north and west corners of the house, leaving a passage for the pilgrims. But many pilgrims make wide their circle at this point. So he's talking about the Hatim or the Hijr of Ismail. So it seems like he's referencing what people do today, in which case nobody goes through the Hijr, right? Nobody cuts through the Hatim. Everybody, all the Madahib, all the sects, everybody goes around. You only go in there if you want to pray to get the barakah of praying in the Kaaba necessarily. So unless he's speaking about back then, but that also doesn't make sense because there was no Hijr back then, right? It didn't really exist in the way that it does now with that oval. So this idea that all the pilgrims, I mean, everybody goes around the Hijr, and everybody knows that if you cut through, it will not count as one of your circuits of Tawaf. You'll have to redo that circuit. And he mentioned that again on the following page as well. And then chapter, so I think that's it from at least what we're going to cover up to, which is hopefully we'll get through this, the vow to sacrifice the son, which is the fifth. So we'll pick up where we left off, which is basically that Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail built the Kaaba. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them, and they set to this task. They built it, as we mentioned before, as a rectangle, and that was its original shape. And it was only later, when the Quraysh had to rebuild it, that they ran out of funds, that they cut short. And that's why it took its cube shape. Between now and then, it has gone back and forth a little bit. Ibn Zubair, when he rebuilt it after it was damaged in the war, he built it that way. And the way that we know that it was like that is because the Prophet ﷺ says that if it wasn't for your being so near to Jahiliyyah, although this was after the Hijrah, that I would have preferred to make it the way Ibrahim did. And he mentions a few things. One, its height increasing to two doors. One to go in and one to go out. Basically, anybody could just kind of go in and out, like a revolving door system. And its original shape to be a rectangle. So some of these different things. So when they built it, they obviously built it in line with that. And so that's where we have the sense from the Prophet ﷺ explaining to us what it used to be, and that his desire was to have it go back to that way. But after Imam Malik's time, when some of the rulers wanted to change it, and he said, if you do this, everybody's going to do it. All the rulers who come are going to change it back and forth to what they think. And that's not appropriate for the Kaaba to over and over again be brought down and brought up again. So he said, let's just leave it the way it is. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he also left it the way it was. And so that's why it remains in the cube shape, you know, and likely that's what it will remain, you know, for at least our lifetimes. So they built it up, you know, in whatever way they could. It wasn't obviously exactly the way that it is right now. There is the footprints of Ibrahim alayhi salam, what they call Maqam Ibrahim, which is close to the door of the Kaaba. So that's actually the place where Ibrahim alayhi salam used to stand. And it said that actually slab of rock would actually move up and down it would basically levitate. So that's how he was able to, with ease, do the higher portions. And so his imprints are in there, and you can go, and anybody who's been there can see it. And it's in a little sort of glass and coat enclosure with some gold decoration and whatnot. And so it's still there that you can see. The other thing worth mentioning is Hajar al-Aswad was actually not from Earth, in the sense that it wasn't something that they dug up and they found this black stone and they decided to set it. It was brought down to them by the angels. So wherever it's from Jannah, arguably, or other worldly place, that it was brought down by the angels and given to Ibrahim and Ismail, and then they placed it where it was. And it was actually originally white. When it first came down, it was white. And according to the narration, from the sins of man, because you kiss Hajar Aswad, ideally, which is difficult nowadays, but ideally with every round you would go and kiss it. So from the sins of man being absorbed into the rock, the white turned black. And if you see it now, it's pure pitch black that's there. So they built the Kaaba together. You know, Ibrahim passes away eventually. Ismail continues on with his life, and we mentioned the story about his father visiting him and telling him to change the frame on the door. So he divorced his first wife, and he got married again. So the second wife that he married was from the tribe of Jurhum. Okay, so Ismail, because of what his mother had done, would have rights over Zamzam. Because she said, you guys can stay here, to Jurhum, these Arabs from Yemen, that you guys can stay here, but the water is mine. So it would have passed on to Ismail. So it would have been in his control. So we have to understand, how did it leave the control of Ismail? And so basically at that time, it was Ismail and now his descendants, and then the people of Jurhum in the area. So he actually married one of the women of Jurhum. Okay, so there's sort of now the mixing between the two lines that were existing in Mecca during that time. So then when Ismail passes away, the Jurhumites essentially become the caretakers of Zamzam, because now the two have sort of come together, and so it makes sense that it would be somewhere in that line that they would take over. So they take over as the caretakers of Zamzam, and in that time, no water, no power, water, power, they become the rulers of Mecca. As usual, people who have a lot of power and don't have necessarily rules and laws to keep them in check, they get out of control. So the Jurhum, the tribe of Jurhum, the Jurhumites, they start oppressing people, and most importantly, they start making it hard for people to make the pilgrimage. And this is still, from the very beginning, one of the things that people were proud of, that we maintain the Kaaba, we water the pilgrims, we feed them, we facilitate people coming to the house of Allah. So they were doing a lot of different things that they should not have been doing, and obviously, because of the Kaaba, because of Ismail's tradition, because of the water, Mecca is growing now. So other tribes are also, other people are also settling. So there's another tribe called Khuza'a, Banu Khuza'a. They basically see that the Jurhumites are going to extremes. They're no longer being fair and just. So they kick them out. So they fight. There's a battle that's fought. The Jurhumites lose, and they're basically expelled from Mecca. Now, as they're leaving, they do something, which is basically they take, because they have to leave quickly, so they can't carry everything that they have. So one, they take all the treasure that they can, any gold, silver, you know, whatever jewelry, valuable stuff they can get, they want to take it with them as they're fleeing. And as they're leaving, they also want to cover up Zamzam. They want to hide the well of Zamzam. Right? So perhaps they thought that, you know what, let's go out, we'll regroup, we'll get reinforcements, maybe we'll go to Yemen, get some of our tribesmen back, we'll come back, we'll take over again. For whatever reason, they had this idea. So they took a lot of the treasure and they dumped it in the well, and then they sealed it up, and they basically buried it. Okay? And again, remember that because of Hajar, you know, trying to keep the water in, it limited its flow. Right? And we mentioned the narration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding this. So it was something that could be capped up, essentially. So they throw all the treasure in there, and then they close it up, and they make it so that nobody knows what's there. Now, obviously, it's a bit strange that the people of Khuza'a wouldn't have just dug it up again, because they would have had some sense of where it is, because it's close to the Kaaba. So for whatever reason, they didn't do this. It's possible that they didn't know exactly where it was and were worried about disturbing the Kaaba, but it's not clear how religious they were either necessarily. So for whatever reason, they didn't search out Zamzam. Right? Maybe this is Allah's taking that blessing away from these people. So they didn't seek it out. So now they have their leader, this Amr bin Nuhay, who's one of the leaders of Khuza'a. He's important. But one, this whole thing is important because what we're trying to do is get to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we're trying to give a bit of the lineage, which hopefully we'll finish today to make it a bit easy. He's also important because he is the first person who brought an idol into Mecca. And I think in the book itself, it sort of gives the idea that there were already a lot of idols there. But I think the better opinion is that there weren't. There was polytheism going on, a fire, sun, moon, stars, these different things. But there weren't all of these idols spread all around. And it was actually this Amr of Khuza'a who brought the first idol into Mecca. And so he was traveling out, either Syria or Palestine, in that area, Philistine. And he saw one of these idols, and he asked the person that, what is this? And they said that this is the means that we get close to God. We use this through that. And when we pray to this idol for rain, we get rain. And when we pray to the idol for sustenance, we get sustenance. And he says, well, I need one of these, right? Somebody pulls out the iPhone, hey, what is that? Oh, you can do this, you can do this, SMS, you can, you know, oh, I need one of those. So he said, I need one of those, can I have one? So they give him this idol called Hubal. So this is the first idol, and he brings it back into Mecca. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually mentions him in a narration, that I saw him in the fire, and he curses him, and he mentions some different things about him. Which is why I think the better thing is that he's actually the first one to bring an idol into Mecca. Okay? And again, he brought this idol because he felt there was benefit in it. Not necessarily to bring it as a contrast against God or Allah or whatever he believed, but he felt like if it's some way for us to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this idea actually exists even today, that people take things too far. So giving people too high of a position. So people start doing sajda to other people. They worship at their graves and they do these different types of things. The reason why they do it is not because they say, you know what, let's go do shirk. Right? Friday night, let's go out shirking. That's not why they do these things. It's not that simple. I mean, we should take a little bit to understand, because if you want to bring them out of that, you cannot just take this, you know, black and white view. So you have to sort of understand the reason they're doing it is because they felt a deficiency. Just like we feel a deficiency, that we stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it's not, you know, we don't have the tawakkul that we should. We're not doing things that we know we should be doing. That's where it started with them. The problem is that they did not allow the sunnah and the sharia to bind that feeling. Okay? Islam is not just emotion, emotion, emotion. Yes, you want that remorse. It has to be there for the tawbah to be accepted. But the sunnah and the sharia have to be the pathway that we walk upon. And those people didn't do that. Although it's very clear, we don't make sajda to people. We don't do ruku to people. We don't pray towards graves. We don't do sajda towards graves. So they let these things get out of hand, and they go one time to somebody, and maybe they happen to make a dua after that person's talk, and their dua gets answered, and they say, hey, wait a minute. Yeah, I've been making that dua for a month, and never got answered, and now it got answered all of a sudden. So then they go back, and then it continues on, and then it gets out of hand. And this is exactly what happened. So one idol comes, somebody sees it, and says, hey, if one can do this, what can two do for us? And we'll get double the rain, we'll get double the provision, we'll get double the sustenance, then three, then four, and this is how it goes. And then there's no end to it. And this is what happened. It just kept going and going and going. And once these idols became a little bit established, people would come to also frequent them. So now the people of Mecca want this, because they want people coming to Mecca so that it's a center. People coming and going and trading. It's a metropolitan city, essentially, building. And this is what you want. And this is what New York, Chicago, LA, all these places, if you look at them, they've always wanted people coming in. They've wanted a mix of people within the cities to give this sense. So it's the same thing that happened over here. So more and more idols are brought, and then every time a tribe comes and leaves their idol, they're going to come back to visit that idol. So again, it's ensuring tourism to the area. Some of the same things that we see people doing today. So the Arabs like this, and it brings in business, because every time these people come, they're buying stuff, they're bringing stuff, there's trading, there's commerce going on, right? The economy is getting a lift. So now various different tribes, they're growing, marriage. The tribes of Ismail are essentially growing in size and number, his descendants. They all obviously can't stay close to the Kaaba, although in the beginning that's what it was like. So they start going into the outskirts and then further into the outskirts, right? You start in D.C., you go into the suburbs, you go further into the suburbs, and then, you know, 60 miles away is normal for people. So this happens over there. So a lot of the descendants of Ismail, they spread out into different areas. And it's the Quraysh in particular that stay in Mecca. Because obviously we need to get to the Quraysh, because that's what's going to take us all the way through into the Seerah. So this is where the Quraysh come into play. That they were one of the descendants of Ismail, one of the many tribes that came, and they stayed in Mecca, and in particular close to the Kaaba, and they had a role always in playing, in taking care of the Kaaba and the pilgrims that come and different people. So they stay in Mecca, and they're called the descendants of Adnan. And anybody who had the Bidayat al-Sul book, in some of the footnotes it mentions Adnan once or twice. So this is where this idea comes from. That somewhere above the tribe of Quraysh was somebody called Adnan. And from there descended one or two generations, then the Quraysh came and it kept going forward and forward and forward. So they're called the descendants of Adnan. Now the leader of the Quraysh is this person named Qusay. So he is the head of the Quraysh. Khuza'a is still around as well, and they still have their claim to what's going on. He actually marries one of the daughters of the chiefs of Khuza'a. So there's this one chief, his name is Khulail, and Qusay marries his daughter. So now, again, emerging, just like Jurhum and Bani Ismail were sort of merged together with a marriage, Khuza'a and Quraysh kind of get brought together through a marriage. Not only that, this Khulail prefers Qusay to his own children. So he's giving preference to a Qurayshi over a Khuza'i. So that gives him a chance as well to sort of get a stronger foothold in there for the Quraysh. And he's also very charming, he's very handsome, he's very personable, a lot of leadership skills. So he sort of rises to the top. There's some fighting that goes on, some disputes that happen, but he sort of comes out on top. And with him, the Quraysh now sort of take over. So in his hands, he's able to unify the Quraysh, and with that, he's in charge of all the different government bodies, basically. And there's any number of them, like you have today. Department of this, department of that. So one person for the food of the pilgrims, one for the water of the pilgrims, one for the banner of war, one for who can call parliament. So we need to have a discussion, who can call the adult members together and have a discussion. So there's, you know, someone who holds the banner, department of this, department, there's like 20, 30 different departments. So he brings all of them together under Quraysh. So Quraysh is sort of seizing control now of Mecca, and with it the Kaaba, and with it of what will be down the road, Zamzam. So he unites everything together. Now the Quraysh are in charge of everything, including hosting the pilgrims, and when Qusay passes on and dies, he gives it to his children. And then when they pass on, it gets spread down. So we'll skip ahead one generation, and we'll get to the grandson of Qusay, whose name is Amr. Okay, so the grandson of Qusay, we're skipping one generation, the grandson of Qusay, his name is Amr, and he takes charge of feeding and watering the pilgrims. Okay, despite Zamzam not being around, you still have to give water to the pilgrims. And by now they've dug other wells, right? I mean, the whole reason you could settle there was for Zamzam. Zamzam is now gone. You might wonder, where's the water coming from? They dug other wells, right? Over time, along with Zamzam, they dug other wells. So this Amr, who is the grandson of Qusay, he's in charge of feeding and watering the pilgrims. And he actually, what you used to do is they would give soup as the meal, right? You have to feed a lot of people when they're coming, so they would make a big soup or a stew type thing, and that's what they would give to everybody who came as free food. So what Amr does is he makes a change to the soup. And what he does is he takes bread and he crushes it up and he throws it inside the soup. Soup and bread go together. Even today, you go anywhere, you get soup and bread. Right? Even to this very day. So he takes that bread, and he crushes it up, and he throws it inside of the soup. So he's basically increasing the nourishment of the meal. And so this is like a big thing now. Everybody's noticing that all the free food just got better. So this is where this Amr actually gets the name of Hashim. Because Hashim means the one who crushes something. And Hashim, that name we probably heard from the different seerah books before. So this is Hashim, who comes along now. So he is the great-grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we're slowly making our way down to where we need to get. Okay, so Banu Hashim is the term that everybody's familiar with. That's who Hashim is. His real name is Amr, because he was the one who was crushing the bread. He became Hashim, and then Banu Hashim came from this. So he starts this tradition. He's also the one who started the travel route up to Syria and to Yemen. لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ إِلَافِهِمْ رِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ. He's the one who starts this tradition. And so often he's also traveling that route as well. And this route also plays in when we get into the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as he's going up one time towards Sham, he stops by in Yathrib, which Medina is Yathrib, and he gets married over there to a woman, and her name is Salma. And she's from a good family and from nobility, and so they lay one condition on him, that you can marry her and you can take her back, obviously. I mean, you go where the husband is going to go. But if she is to bear any children, then she comes back to Medina and she gives birth in Medina. So this is a condition that's laid. He says, no problem. That's fine. I'm coming and going anyways, up and down. Otherwise, it is a decent distance. He says, no problem that he does this. So on one of his trips, after she gets pregnant, so he takes her to fulfill his oath. He's going up that way anyways, drops her off in Medina and keeps going. And then he passes away on his journey. So now his wife is in Medina, Salma, and she's pregnant. And so she stays there, obviously, because that's where her tribe is, that's where her parents are, that's where her clan is. And so he passes away in Gaza. And so he's buried to this day in Gaza. She gives birth to a son, and so they name him Sheba, which is sort of an odd name, because Sheba means old man, like an old person. Right? So you don't normally name a baby old man. Right? So either because some say that he had some a streak of white when he was born in his hair, right? White like an old man, so they called him old man, they called him Sheba, or his hair looked like that of an old man, or because they wanted like a dua, basically, that we hope he becomes an old man, yani that he has a long life. Right? So for these different reasons, they call him Sheba. So he's brought up in Medina, and he also, because he's in the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so he shows a lot of the leadership characteristics. Very handsome, you know, good at dealing with other people, strong, a good speaker, eloquent, all of these different things. So as he gets a little bit older, his uncle Muttalib, who's Hashim's brother, he goes to Medina to claim him because he needs somebody in Medina. I mean, the other place is Mecca, right, to run the Kaaba and everything. Yathrib is Yathrib at this point. The Prophet doesn't come there. It's nothing special. And he sees all these traits coming in him. So he wants to groom him to be the successor in his line. So he goes to them and says that you have to give him to me. Right? And basically what he's doing is he's giving the right of the father. And this actually exists to this day in the Sharia, that the father has a right over the children. So he goes, and they say no, and he says, look, you know, he's a leader. You know, he praises him in front of the mother, in front of the clan. He has a lot of capabilities, a lot of abilities. He's not going to manifest them here in Yathrib. Let me take him back to Mecca. He'll be a leader. He'll be in charge of watering the pilgrims. He'll have all of these different things that he does, and he'll become a great leader. So they say, okay, so you can take him. So he takes him, so this Muttalib takes him and goes back to Mecca. Now everybody knows Muttalib in Mecca. He's one of the leaders in there. And they know who his children are and who his children aren't. So when they see him coming into Mecca with this young lad riding on the animal, they assume he was a slave. Because slave trade was very common. And if you were going to buy a slave, better to buy him when he's 13, 14, 15, when he's young, get him in the family, he's got a lot of strength, and raise him up. So this is Abdul Muttalib. Right? So this name is very familiar to everybody. He's actually Sheba. And because he was mistook as the slave of Muttalib, they called him the slave of Muttalib, or the servant of Muttalib. So this is the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's mentioned, you know, all these, you know, we skipped over some of it, but this is actually very important if you really want to do a proper study of the Seerah and understand down the road the tribal affiliations and the wars and sort of what was going on. You do need to understand more even than what we sort of quickly went over. And it does matter because the Prophet mentioned in a narration, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose from Bani Ismail, the best of the people of Ismail, he chose Banu Kinana. And from Kinana, he chose the Quraysh. And from Quraysh, he chose Hashim, the one who was crushing the bread. And from Hashim, he chose Abdul Muttalib, Sheba, this person who was mistaken. And from Abdul Muttalib, he chose Abdullah. And from there, he chose the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he mentioned even in the lineage. And this is the idea that you could go, if you wanted to, and trace all the way back the nur of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam moving from one person to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next, all the way down. And this actually has, you know, a proper place. And so I think there's not much time, so we'll stop here. And then we'll pick up from this, the recovery of Zamzam.